Hello all. Welcome to today's class of EC 202 Signals and Systems subject. In this class, we'll be mainly dealing with some of the problems of DTFS. In the previous classes, we had already seen a brief introduction to DTFS, a brief introduction to DTFT, the properties of DTFS and DTFT, as well as we discussed some of the problems that is coming under DTFS and DTFT. So today, let's start our class with the question given below. Find x of n for x of k given below as x of k is equal to cos 6 pi by 17 k. So here you are given with the DTFS representation, that is x of k, and you are asked to find out the discrete time signal x of n. So we'll begin this question. Solving this question by identifying the value of omega. So from the question it's clear that omega has got the value 6 pi by 70. And we know that we mainly have three steps for finding the DTFS representation. That is, in the first step we'll find out omega. In the second step we will calculate the fundamental period n naught, which is given by the formula 2 pi m by omega. And here we'll have the value of omega 6 pi by 17, so here m is not written. 2 pi by 6 pi by 17, that is giving the value for omega, and in the next case this pi and pi will get cancelled and 2 and 6 get cancelled, so this becomes 17 m by 3. This should be m actually, because it is written m. It can be either m or n, so 17 m by 3. And you have to give the value of m in such a way that this becomes an integer, that is the value of fundamental period becomes an integer, and in order to make it an integer, the value of m should be clearly, it should be equal to 3. Then only we will get the value of fundamental period as n naught is equal to 17 by 3 into 3 is equal to 17. So in this step we have solved for the fundamental period value, that is n naught. And in the third step what we are going to find out is the fundamental frequency omega naught, that is the third step. And we know that the fundamental frequency omega naught is given by 2 pi by n naught, where n naught is 17. So the fundamental frequency omega naught becomes 2 pi by 17. Hence, we have got the fundamental period as 17. So it's always better to take the value of n as well as k belonging to the set minus 8 to 8. Because minus 8 to 8 means it has got 17 elements and it makes the period is equal to 17. So it's always good to take it as symmetric about the origin, that is symmetric about 0. Instead of taking it as 0 to 16, it will be convenient if you are taking it like this. So that will be understood while proceeding through the problem. And in the next step, we have written the equation for x of k. This is 1 by n naught. It can be n naught or n, because here n naught is equal to n. So 1 by n naught sigma n is equal to minus 8 to 8, because we have written here we'll include the value of n as minus 8 to 8, the limit as minus 8 to 8. So it is n is equal to minus 8 to 8 x of n e raised to minus jk omega naught n. In the next step, we will substitute the value of n as 17. This is actually n naught. So n naught's value is 17. And here also we'll substitute for the value of omega naught as 2 pi by 17. So we get sigma n is equal to minus 8 to 8 x of n e raised to minus jk. Instead of omega naught, we will substitute its value, that is 2 pi by 17 into n. So that is denoted as equation number 1. That is, we got a representation like this for the x of k. Next, we are proceeding to the initial step, that is the question. The question given is x of k is equal to cos 6 pi by 17 k. And we know that this cos theta form, it can be written by using Euler's equation as e raised to j theta plus e raised to minus j theta by 2. So this can be written as, here the value of theta is 6 pi by 17 k. So it can be written as e raised to j 6 pi by 17 k plus e raised to minus j 6 pi by 17 k by 2. So that is marked as equation number 2. So here you can see equation number 1 as well as 2. Both of these equations, that will give the expression for x of k, that is the LHS are same, x of k and here also x of k. So both these equations should be equal. So we can actually compare the RHS. This RHS portion can be compared and we can find out the value of x of n. So that is what is being done in the next step. That is, we will equate equation 1 and 2 and we will equate the exponential parts. That is, by equating the exponential parts, we will get that this thing becomes xn by 17. Xn by 17 is equal to, this is 1 by 2. The other whole portions, they belong to the exponential representation. That is, here it is e raised to minus jk 2 pi by 17 n, and here it is e raised to j 6 pi by 17 k and e raised to minus j 6 pi by 17 k. So here you have got, in excluding this exponential part, here you have got the portion 1 by 2 and here you have got the portion xn by 17. So on comparing this exponential parts, we can very well write what is the value of x of n. That is, it becomes xn by 17 is equal to 1 by 2 for n is equal to plus or minus 3. Because on comparing, you will get here, if you are giving n is equal to plus 3, it becomes e raised to minus j 6 pi by 17 k. So this is when n is equal to plus 3, and when it is minus 3, it becomes, when n is equal to minus 3, it becomes e raised to j k 6 pi by 17. That is this portion. So for plus or minus 3, this becomes xn by 17. Xn by 17 is equal to half for n is equal to plus or minus 3. So we are asked to find out. The question is to find out x of n. So if you are taking this 17 to here, we will get x of n has got value 17 by 2 for n is equal to plus or minus 3. And it has got value equal to 0 for otherwise. So what we are just performing here is just simple comparison of this equation with the Euler's expanded form of the question. So just by comparing the values, by giving the values, here you are giving the values for n. When it was asked us to find out the value of x of k, we will compare it with values of k. Here you are asked to find out the values of x of n, so you will compare it with the values by giving values to n. Here if you are giving value n is equal to plus 3 and minus 3, you will get the corresponding values of x of n. So that is how you have found out the value of x of n. Hope it's clear. The next question, you are asked to find out, evaluate the DTFS coefficient for the signal. X of n is equal to sine 4 pi by 21 n plus cos 10 pi by 21 n plus 1. So this is actually a composite signal. And we have already studied in the first module how to find the periodicity if you're given with a composite signal. You need to actually compute the GCD for finding the periodicity of a composite signal. And here we'll have a comparison. That is, in the first, let this be my first signal, that is x1 of n, and let this be the second signal x2 of n, and let the value of omega 1, that is the value of frequency over here, let it be denoted by omega 1. Here it is 4 pi by 21, and the value of omega 2 here is 10 pi by 21. So first you need to have a common omega. So, in order to find the common omega also, we will find out the GCD of omega 1 and omega 2. So, GCD is found as usual, and we get one is 4 and the other one is 10. The other rest elements are the same, pi by 21. So, no need to find out for that. We'll just find out the GCD of 4 and 10, and we'll get the GCD of 4 and 10 as 4 can be written as 2 into 2 and 10 can be written as 2 into 5. Naturally, GCD is 2. So, the GCD value of omega 1 and omega 2 is represented by the term omega, and omega is the GCD of omega 1 comma omega 2, and that is 2 pi by 21. This 2 is from this value, and pi by 21, it is common from this omega 1 and omega 2. So we get the value of omega as 2 pi by 21. And in the next step, as usual, we got the value of omega. In the next step, in the second step, we will find out the value of fundamental period, that is n naught is equal to 2 pi by omega into m, and here omega's value is 2 pi by 21, and this 2 pi gets cancelled, and when m is equal to 21, that is when m is equal to 1, it becomes this 2 pi and this 2 pi gets cancelled, so it becomes 21, and omega naught we get it as 2 pi by 21. Okay, because 2 pi by n naught is omega naught. Now again, we are going to apply the Euler's formula to the main question. That is, here the question is sine term is here, cos term is here, and you have got a plus 1 term. And for sine, we will write the Euler's representation. For cos also, we will write the Euler's representation and we will expand it. So we'll see how we are doing it. That is using Euler's formula. We know that sine is written as 1 by 2j e raised to j theta minus e raised to minus j theta. Here the value of theta is 4 pi by 21. So it becomes 1 by 2j e raised to j 4 pi by 21 n minus e raised to minus j 4 pi by 21 n plus the next term is cos term. So cos is e raised to j theta plus e raised to minus j theta by 2. So it becomes half e raised to j 10 pi by 21 n plus e raised to minus j 10 pi by 21 n plus 1. This one is the remaining one that is there in the question, this dc term. Okay, so that is also being written over here and it's being expanded. We'll take these terms to inside the bracket. So it becomes 1 by 2j e raised to j 4 pi by 21 n minus 1 by 2j e raised to minus j 4 pi by 21 n plus half e raised to j 10 pi by 21 n plus half e raised to minus j 10 pi by 21 n plus 1. So this is equation number 1. Hope it's clear. We just wrote down the Euler's expansion and we just expanded it by taking the terms outside the bracket to inside the bracket. And then we have got that the value of n naught is 21. So that is being substituted over here. That is, we'll give the value. 21 means we have to take it symmetric about 0. So it becomes the index limit will become k is equal to minus 10 to plus 10. And so we'll write this equation, the standard equation of x of n, as x of k e raised to jk omega naught n, and we'll substitute for omega naught in the next step, that is x of k e raised to jk omega naught's value is 2 pi by 21 n. So on comparing this equation 1 and equation 2, this whole is equation 1 and this whole is equation 2, we can get that when k is equal to 0, the value of x of k is 1. Here you can see, here there is a term called 1. Here, there is a term called 1. This happens when k is equal to 0. Similarly, we can find that when k is equal to plus 2. When k is equal to plus 2 means it becomes x of 2 into e raised to j 4 pi by 21 n. So, we will see what is its e raised to j 4 pi by 21 n. This is the term. So, for that, the coefficient is 1 by 2j. So, when k is equal to 2, we get 1 by 2j. When k is equal to minus 2, we get this as minus 1 by 2j. Same way, when k is equal to 5, we will get 1 by 2. And for k is equal to minus 5, we will get 1 by 2. This is just by substituting. Here, there is no k term. It means that k has assumed some value. K, when it is equal to 2, then on comparing with this equation, we can get these coefficients. Okay. So, we get it like this, that is for k is equal to 0, the value of x of k is 1, k is equal to plus 2, it is 1 by 2j, k is equal to minus 2, it is minus 1 by 2j, just comparison of equation 1 and 2. And for k is equal to plus as well as minus 5, we get it as half half. So, we will just write it down again, that is the value of x of k is equal to 1, for k is equal to 0, 1 by 2j when k is equal to 2, minus 1 by 2j when k is equal to minus 2, half when k is equal to 5, and half when k is equal to minus 5. Still there are some more points because it is from minus 10 to 10, the index of k. So for all other points, the value of x of k is equal to 0. Okay, hope it's clear. We are just comparing and writing. And the next step, what we are going to find out is the magnitude spectrum as well as the phase spectrum. We know that the formula for magnitude spectrum is given by x of k, mode x of k is equal to root of a square plus b square, where A is the real part and B is the imaginary part. And we know that if you are comparing, that is for k is equal to 0, there is only real part. For k is equal to 2, there is only imaginary part, that is, there is only B. So, like that, if you are computing root of A square plus B square for each term, we will get it like this. That is, for k is equal to 0, the value is 1. For k is equal to minus 5, 5, minus 2 and plus 2, the value is 1 by 2. It is just doing root of a square plus b square. And it is 0 for all other k. In the next step, we are going to find out the phase spectrum. This phase spectrum is given by the formula tan inverse of b by a. Same way, we are going to find out, that is for k is equal to 2, the value is 1 by 2j. Here you have written it. That is for k is equal to 2, the value of x of k is 1 by 2j. And this 1 by 2j means it is the B part, that is the imaginary part. So this 1 by 2j, it can be just rewritten as, you can take this j to the numerator side, so it becomes minus j by 2. So that the value of b becomes minus 1 by 2. We don't take this j, because there is j, it is the b term. It is the imaginary part term. So the value of b is equal to minus 1 by 2, and the value of a is equal to 0 here, because you don't have a real term here. And in order to find out the phase, we will perform the computation tan inverse of b by a, that is tan inverse of minus half by 0. Anything divided by 0, it becomes infinity. So here there is minus, so it becomes tan inverse of minus infinity, which is equal to minus pi by 2. Okay, hope it's clear. Same way for minus 2, it becomes minus 1 by 2j. If you are taking this j upside to the numerator, it becomes j by 2, and the value of b becomes half, and here also no real part, so a is equal to 0. And tan inverse of b by a means it is tan inverse of half by 0, so it is tan inverse of plus infinity, which is equal to pi by 2. Okay. In the next section, we have got points at k is equal to 5 and minus 5, that is equal to half. So here there is only real part, there is no imaginary part over here. So the real part, the value of real part is equal to a is equal to half. So tan inverse of b by a, b's value is 0 by half. Tan inverse of 0, it is 0. Okay. So for k is equal to 5 and minus 5, the phase is 0. And for k is equal to 0, the value is 1, that is b. Value of b is equal to 0 and a is equal to 1. That is, it has got only real part, which is equal to 1. A is equal to 1 and b is equal to 0. 0 by 1, it becomes tan inverse of 0, 0 to 0. So the phase is also being summarized here. That is, when k is equal to 0 and plus or minus 5, the phase is 0. For k is equal to minus 2, it is pi by 2. For k is equal to 2, it is minus pi by 2, and it is 0 for all other k in the range minus 10 to 10. Okay. Hope this is clear. And just one more problem we are going to deal. That is, determine the Fourier coefficients for the periodic sequence x of n shown in the figure below. Verify the Parseval's identity. You can see that this is actually a periodic sequence of values 0, 1, 2, 3. It is again repeating 0, 1, 2, 3, and it has got period n is equal to 4. So that is being written. The given sequence x of n is periodic extension of 0, 1, 2, 3 with fundamental period n, and n0. This is same as n0. N0 is equal to 4 over here. You need not find it again, because it is very clear from the figure that the value of n0 is equal to 4. So we'll substitute this, actually n0 or n. You can write it either way. Here as n0 is equal to n, you are writing in the same way. So omega0 is equal to 2 pi by n0 it should be. And this is 2 pi by this 4, that is pi by 2. So you are going to find out x of k. X of k has got the value 1 by, this should be n0 actually, 1 by n0. Since n0 is equal to n, no issues. 1 by n0 sigma n is equal to within bracket n0 or n x of n e raised to minus jk omega0. And this is your standard equation for finding DTFS. And here, we'll write it as 0 to 3. X of n e raised to minus j k 2 pi by 4. Okay. So, in the next step, we will give value for values of n. That is, first we'll substitute x of n is equal to 0. So, it becomes x of 0. When you're substituting n is equal to 1, it becomes x of 1 into e raised to minus j k 2 pi by 4 k. In the next step, we'll substitute for n is equal to 2. So, it becomes x of 2 into e raised to minus j 4 pi by 4k, and the next step we will substitute n is equal to 3, becomes x of 3 raised to minus j 6 pi k by 4. So this is how your x of k is. Now in the next step we will give value for k. That is, k is equal to 0 if you are giving, then it becomes 1 by 4 into 0 plus 1 into e raised to 0 plus 2 into e raised to 0 plus 3 into e raised to 0. That is, we know that the value of x of 1 is, you can compare it. The value of x of 0. The value of x of 0 is 0. Value of x of 1 is 1. Value of x of 2 is 2. Value of x of 3 is 3. So that is what you are going to give in the next step. We will give value for k. K you will give. And you will substitute for x of 0 as 0. X of 1 as 1. X of 2 as 2. And x of 3 as 3. So you will get it like this. 1 into e raised to 0. Plus 2 into e raised to 0. Plus 3 into e raised to 0. Because k is given as 0. So it becomes 1 by 4 into 1 plus 2 plus 3. It becomes 6 by 4 is equal to 3 by 2. Okay, in the next step we will give the value of k is equal to 1. So it becomes 1 by 4 into it is 0 plus, this is x of 1. X of 1 is 1 into e raised to minus j 2 pi by 4. That is, in this equation you are giving k is equal to 1. If you are giving k equal to 1, it becomes what? 0 plus 1 into e raised to minus j 2 pi by 4 plus x of 2's value is 2. So 2 into e raised to minus j 4 pi by 4 plus x of 3's value is 3. So 3 into e raised to minus j 6 pi by 4. Okay, that is only what is being written over here. 3 into e raised to minus j 6 pi by 4. You will just simplify. 2 by 4 and all can be made as 1 by 2. This can be made as this 4, 4 get cancelled. It becomes 2 into e raised to minus j pi and becomes e raised to minus j 3 pi by 2. Now, you have to compute the values of this e raised to minus j pi by 2, e raised to minus j pi and e raised to minus j 3 pi by 2. So, that is again computed by using this Euler's formula. That is, e raised to minus j pi by 2 means it is nothing but cos pi by 2 minus j sin pi by 2. So, we will give the value for cos 90 and sin 90, we get it as minus j. Same way, we will compute for e raised to minus j pi. It is cos pi minus j sin pi, it is equal to minus 1. Same way, e raised to minus j 3 pi by 2, we will compute it as 0 plus j. So, substituting these values, that is here you can substitute for e raised to minus j pi by 2, you got it as minus j into 1. So, it is minus j here. And here it is 2 into minus 1. So, it is minus 2. And this is 3 into plus j. So, this is 3j. So, you can just simplify it. It becomes 1 by 4 into 2j minus 2. It is nothing but j by 2 minus half. So, this is the value of x of 1. Okay. Similarly, we will give for k is equal to 2. If you are giving k is equal to 2, we will get it like this. I mean, 0 plus 1 into e raised to minus j, 2 pi into 2 by 4, like that. If you are giving k is equal to 2 also, we will get it like this. And again, we will have a expansion like this. That is, e raised to minus j pi is expanded as cos pi minus j sin pi. You find its value like that, like that. You can get the value of x of 2 as minus 1 by 2. Same way, you can give value of k is equal to 3. And you can compute the value of x of 3 as we computed. So, we get x of 3 as minus half j minus 1 by 2. So, at last, we are asked to prove the Parseval's theorem. So, this is your Parseval's theorem. Parseval's theorem states that 1 by n sigma n is equal to 0 to 3 mod x of n square should be equal to k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 mod x of k whole square. So, here the value of x of n, we know that it has got the value 0, 1, 2 and 3 because it is just a periodic representation and the value of n is 1 by 4. So, we will solve for LHS first. So, it becomes 1 by 4 into 0 plus 1 square plus 2 square plus 3 square. It becomes 1 by 4 into 1 square means it's 1, 2 square it's 4 and 3 square it's 9 and it becomes equal to 7 by 2. So, you are done with the LHS. And next, we are going to solve for the RHS portion. RHS, we got the values of x of k. Like we got the value of x of 0, x of 1, x of 2. We are just going to substitute. X of 0 is 3 by 2. X of 1, it is j by 2 minus half. X of 2, we got it as minus half. And x of 3, we got it as minus j by 2 minus half. So, we'll substitute that in this equation. That is, here you are asked to find out mod x of k whole square for all the values. So, we'll have 3 by 2 whole square plus all the other term, that is x of 0, x of 1, x of 2 and x of 3. We'll just add it up by taking the LCM and we get the value as 7 by 2. So, this is the same value that we got when we computed the LHS also. So, we can say that the Parseval's theorem or the Parseval's identity is verified in this question. So, hope you all are clear how to find out the value of x of n if you are given with x of k and how to find out x of k if you are given with x of n. That's all for the problems of DTFS. So, with this we are winding up the session on DTFS. And in the next session we will be seeing how to find out the DTFT of the signal. That's all. Thank you all.